First of all, I would like to thank the course team, especially Pooja and Leon, for the invitation to participate in this symposium and to come to India for the first time, and Ramona and Sitara for organizing everything with so much care. My presentation today is not exactly a keynote speech, but a reunion of some material and ideas that I would like to share with you, trying to open some ways into it and hopefully bringing enough information and leaving enough space so that we can have a discussion about it in relation to what we already heard in the symposium yesterday. It will be a combination of a few voices, that of Lygia Clark through some of her writings, that of Suely Rolnik through her writings and a clip from the interview from the archive, and also short excerpts of the videos with our Guy Brett, Caetano Veloso, and Gaed from the archive as well. So this archive built by Suely Rolnik is that you will understand during my presentation is a way of activating the 26 years of very relevant artistic practice that is not based on objects, but rather in the relation or fusion between the work and the receiver, or the outer spectator, as Lygia Clark would write, happening in the instant as action. So this is a question that follows my work as a curator since I started and takes form in different ways in each exhibition, conference, text, or book I organize. And the question is how to represent artistic practices that are not based on objects in the present time. How to bring them to a public sphere with the same power and urgency of when it was first realized as an art. So I shall start by presenting the work of Brazilian artist Lygia Clark, not only for those who are not familiar with it, but also for us to look at it from a different perspective that cannot, in my view, be experienced in a traditional exhibition. As for example, in a museum like the Museum of Modern Art in New York, where there has been recently a retrospective of all her work. The title of the exhibition last year at MoMA is enough to make clear the misunderstandings of her practice, even amongst curators and art historians until today. It's called Lygia Clark, The Abandonment of Art. And I believe you will understand during my presentation why, in my view, this is such an unfortunate title for a retrospective of her work. And of course, this is the kind of exhibition that will state for what, how she stands in an international understanding. So I will start reading a paragraph by Suely Rolnik from a text from 2007 called The Body's Contagious Memory, Lygia Clark's Return to the Museum, where she writes a little bit about why she did this archive. So I quote, in 1969, Lygia Clark wrote, and I quote inside the quote, at the very moment when the artist digests the object, he is digested by society, which has already found him a title and a bureaucratic function. He will be the future engineer of leisure, an activity that has no effect whatsoever on the equilibrium of social structures. So end of quote by Lygia Clark and continued by Suely. This short text, a kind of prophecy, is proof of her acute lucidity regarding the perverse effects of cultural capitalism in the territory of art as early as 1969, when the new regime was just barely visible on the horizon before it became more clearly established from the end of the 70s on. The forms of critique that Lygia put into action in her proposals over the following two decades would find their resonance only 10 years after her death, in the recent extradisciplinary drift undertaken by the new generation. In the face of this obvious resonance and consequently of the collective support that was now offered for the artist's critical gesture, which had at the same time been whipped out by the way that her recent work had been incorporated by the market, I decided to undertake a project for the construction of memory around her artistic trajectory, which I developed from 2002 to 2007. The intention of this project was to create the conditions for reactivating the impact of the work at the very moment of its return to the institutional terrain of art. She organized a book in 1983 where she went back through her whole production and did and put herself put some series of the work into reflections or names so that it was more understandable somehow. So I start with this on the instant. The instant of the act is not renewed. It exists by itself. To repeat it is to give it a new meaning. It contains no trace of past perception. It's another moment. At the same moment at which it takes place, it's already something in itself. Only the instant of the act is alive. In it, the future being is inscribed. The instant of the act is the only living reality in ourselves. Becoming aware is already in the past. Brute perception of the act is the future being made. The present and the future are implied in the now present of the act. So then I will, for those who didn't know before, so Lygia Clark is this Brazilian artist, born in 1920 and died in 1988. So I will go quickly through the beginning of her work just to create this line where we understand that the culmination of her work and the 26 years of corporeal experiences was not a way of going out of art, but it has been, since the beginning, the crucial motive for her production. So she started as a painter. She was a student of the French painter Fernand Léger in Paris, and this is 53. And as early as 54, there was already this series called Breaking of the Frame. So she was already, she was doing a painting in wood, and she already, she had this cut where she would start to articulate about the line, the black line there. It's not a graphic line, but it's what she would call an organic line, which is the space between the two pieces. So this is 54. And then 55, there's this series of modulated surface, where it's already like one piece of wood. And I don't know if you can see here, but there's some traces after the, like up, that are cuts in the wood. And if you look at this painting from the profile, it has like a belly like this. So this is already this research of this organic line and how this modulates the plan and the surfaces. And this is from 57, planes on modulated surface. And again, this shows what is the organic line. This is not a graphic line. Again, this is four pieces of wood put together and become a painting. And this one, modulated space, is it's an overlaying of two different pieces of wood. So when you see like the painting, it's 40 by 40. And the white line is actually the space between one layer and the next one of wood. So this is Lygia Clark in this important exhibition, the Neoconcreta, Mostra Neoconcreta in 59. And from this breaking the surface with these organic lines, she then starts to go out of the plane. And she started working with pontine. And so this is what she would call the cocoons. And there was a series of it as well. So it started coming out of the painting until she got into this bichus. And all of this that I show, if any of you have been in any exhibition of Lygia Clark, I mean, you've seen it already. But I think it's very important to take it in order to understand the whole idea of her work. So the bichus are this plan that you can then fold, and they are always in this state of becoming. And I will read like very short about what Lygia Clark again about the bichus. So the bichu was in, I'm sorry. The bichu has its own circuit of movements which react to the stimuli of the person. It's not made up of independent and static forms which can be manipulated easily and indefinitely, like in a game. On the contrary, its parts are functionally related, like those of a true organism, and the movement of these parts is interdependent. So this is a machine, this is the stripped. And again, continuing Lygia Clark on the issue, it is a living organism, an essentially active work. Between you and it, there is the establishing of a total existential interaction. In the relationship established between you and the Bishu, there is no passiveness, neither yours nor its. There is a type of body-to-body relation between two living entities. In fact, there is a dialogue in which the Bishu has very well-defined answers of its own for the spectator's stimuli. This relationship between the man and the Bishu, previously metaphorical, becomes real. In the relationship between you and the Bishu, there are two types of movement. The first one, made by you, it's purely external. The second one, by the Bishu, made by the Bishu, is produced by the dynamics of its own expressiveness. The first movement, which you make, has nothing to do with the Bishu, because it does not belong to it. In compensation, the conjugation of your gesture with the immediate response by the Bishu creates a new relationship, and this is only possible to the movements which it knows how to make. This is the life of its own, of the Bishu. And with this text and also with this work, I already start thinking about the presentations of yesterday and this idea of what comes from the outside and interferes on you, and what comes from the inside. But I will get better on this. This is the monument for all situations. And this is just to give an idea of how it was presented by then on the floor. And they're quite big, so it's this body-to-body relations. And nowadays, it's impossible. Like, they're always shown in pedestals, and people cannot really manipulate. And the ones the copies they make are very easy to play somehow. And it gives, I think, a very different understanding of it, where this was, they are very hard, and really you move one part and then the other goes. So. But what it's considered like the culmination of her work, or let's say not the culmination, but it's exactly when she could get overpass the object, is the Kamingangu. And again, I'm reading Lygia Clark. So Kamingangu is the name I have given to my last proposition. From there on, I attributed an absolute importance to the immanent act carried out by the participants. Kamingangu has all the possibilities connected to the action itself. It allows choice, the unpredictable, and the transformation of a virtuality into a concrete event. And these are like the instructions. Make the Kamingangu yourself with a white strip of paper around the book. Cut it across its width, twist it and glue it, in order to have a Moebius strip. Then take a pair of scissors, stick a point into the surface, and cut it along its length. Take care not to go into the already cut part, which would separate the strip into two pieces. When you have gone completely round the Moebius strip, choose between cutting to the right or to the left of the cut already made. This notion of choice is decisive, and within it resides the only meaning in this experiment. The work is its act.
Yes. Huh? Is its last act.
No, the work is its act. So there's no division anymore between making the work as an act, and there's no object. And if I use a Moebius strip for this experiment, it's because it breaks our spatial habits, right, left, front, and reverse. So it makes us leave the experience of a time without limit and of a continuous space. And just to finish, each Kamingangu is an immanent reality which is revealed in its totality during the spectator's author's expression time. Initially, the Kamingangu is only a potentiality. You and it will form a unique total existential reality. No separation between subject-object. It's a body-to-body affair, a fusion. The different responses will appear from your choice. A new type of fusion follows on from the dualist relationship between man and Bishu, the work from before, which characterized the previous experiences. In being the work and the act of making the work itself, you and it become totally indissociable. There is only one type of duration, the act. The act is that which produces the caminando. Nothing exists before and nothing afterwards. So from now on, any kind of material she will use or to create her works or any kind of work she will produce, it was always in relation to the experience of the receiver and never considered as an object of art. And it was very hard for her at this moment. She had a recognized career as an artist because of the paintings and the sculptures. And when she went through this way, it was very, especially among her peers, like the artists she was close to, the Brazilians, they really felt like she lost it. But then she, I will show a little bit of this that are also many times showed in exhibition spaces. These are the relational objects, and they were really they were produced with the most easy and inexpensive material anyone could find. So all the works are really about also the possibility of just making it. The artist is the proposer, and so this is a plastic bag with water shells and a rubber band. And so I'll show you a few, and I talk about the relational objects when we get to the structuring of the self. This is another one, and I think here is a good example of, it's possible to understand how difficult it is to present the work of Lygia Clark in any kind of exhibition context that gives more importance to the presentation and the visuality, because, for instance, this kind of structure she developed, they're not supposed to be seen like we are seeing. They are supposed to be, it's an experiment of fusion for those wearing the clothes, and then they used to have like different pockets with different kinds of materials, or so it's really this experience of fusion that will only happen between the ones participating on it. These are the abysmal masks. It's also this kind of net that you buy in this open market, so like with potatoes or orange, and so it's really there's a stone in front and there's a stone in your back, so people would describe it as having this feeling of falling in a void because of the weight of the stone. And these are the googles that also have some, it's also about the relation of the body of the two person. And okay, so. So from 72 to 76, she started, she kind of left the terrain, like the institution, the art institution, and went to Sorbonne and tried to do the experiments with her students. So she had a group of students, and they would do the whole experiment. So this one, it's a proposal in which a net is made by the participant using elastic bands. And this consists of the intertwining of the bodies in the net, forming a collective body. The act of waving the net becomes as important as that of using it after it's ready. So, if the work of Lygia Clark is generally understood under this notion of multisensorial experience, like not only visible, but tactile, smell, as many practices of the time, what Suely works on, the idea is that she went further. So, I will quote. The focus of her investigation consisted in mobilizing the two capacities inherent in each of the senses. I refer to the capacities of perception and sensation that allow us to apprehend the otherness of the world, respectively as a map of forms on which we project representations, or as a diagram of forces that affect all the senses in their capacity of resonance. So, in other words, there's an articulation that Suely makes and that traces back to an understanding of what will be this the key of the motivation of Lygia Clark work, which is this two capacities of the senses that we all have, and one is connected to perception, so all the senses that we use, and one is to the sensorial, so it's this diagram of forces that affect us and resonate in our body. And according to Lygia Clark and then Suely, you need to have, they are a paradoxical, they need to be both activated in our capacities and to connect with one with the other in order for us to be able to be creative, and creative in the sense of producing thought. So I don't know how clear, depending on the place, this gets very, very clear. I felt here it will be, but or if I need to explain more. But it's really about what you see when you enter a place, and so there's people there. And if or what you what the sensorial is more like, you enter a place, you feel something is wrong, you leave. Even if there's nothing supposedly wrong. So, and also a reflection about this is that in the authoritarian regimes, the first capacity of the senses that is repressed and then suppressed is the sensorial capacity. So through humiliation and torture, people lose their capacity to feel what is not visible. So the work of Lygia Clark was really, since its beginning, try to open this in her receiver, like to reconnect the perception and to activate the sensorial that could be repressed and suppressed, and somehow to allow people to relate to. I'm sorry if you're totally out with fever, but trying. So I quote a little bit more. Since she set out on her particular path, Lygia Clark's artistic experimentations thought to mobilize in the receivers of her proposals this resonant apprehension of the world, as well as its paradox in relation to perception, in an attempt to affirm the creative imagination that this differential puts into motion and its transformative effects. The work would no longer be cut short in the spatial finitude of the object. It could now be realized as temporality in an experience in which the object is unreified in order to become a field of living forces that affect the world and are affected by it, bringing about a continuous process of differentiation. So, from after this, when Suely, the last part of her production, it's called The Structuring of the Self, and it's exactly when most of people will say she left art to go to therapy, because she went back to Rio de Janeiro, and the way she will treat or meet her receivers in this case was really like in a clinic as a therapy session. So they would come every week, and she would use this relational object that I showed before. And Lygia says about the relational object, quickly, they have, the relational object has no specific nature in itself. It's defined in their relationship established with the fantasy of the subject. So the same object may express different meanings for different subjects at different moments. And another thing is that they have no physical specificities. Formally, it has no analogy with the body, it's not illustrative, but it creates relationships with it by means of the texture, the weight, the size, the temperature, sound, and movement. So they were never supposed to be looked at or seen in an exhibition space, but they became part of this therapy that I think we go a little bit more when we see a few parts of the archive that's really developed. So, and I quote Suely, at this point, Lygia Clark became aware that the fulfillment of one of the central questions of her artistic research, this reactivation of the quality of aesthetic experience in the receivers of her creation, was not at all self-evident. So, I refer to the capacity of letting oneself be affected by the forces of the objects created by the artist and the environment in which these were experienced. But above all, as a consequence, the capacity of letting oneself be affected by the forces of the environment of one's daily life. It's in the face of this deadlock that the artist created Structuring of the Self, the last gesture of her work, which unfolded after her definitive return to Rio de Janeiro in 76. And then she died in 88 doing this, and very depressed for feeling that her work was not understood. So now I will try to give a bit of an introduction to this archive of interviews that are like that Suely Rolnik did from 2002 to 2007. So there are 66 interviews. Most of them are a steady camera. So she went after all the people that could be related to these corporeal experiments, but also related to the context of this time of the 60s and 70s. And what I think is so interesting about it, or what it really brings it, it's that Suely uses her experience with a psychoanalytic in the clinic. So she would sit with each one of them, and you only have the camera of this person, and they would talk for like an hour and a half. And she's really into letting this memory of the body of these people that resonated in their body in the past to come out. So when you watch these videos, it's really they come to the present. So somehow. You really need to watch with time at least three or five videos in order to start to understand how it builds a network of different kinds of thinkings and way of, but it's exactly in this non-visible part of the of this past, this recent past. So. And then for me, the experience of watching this when I first wrote about it in 2006 was really the most powerful entrance I ever had to the context of what has happened in the 60s and 70s in Brazil before and during dictatorship. So the military intervention took place in a moment of a very fertile ground for production of knowledge and a unique experience of exchange between the different fields of art in Brazil. Was the only time when like artists and musicians, and there was the cinema novo, the new cinema, and architecture. So they were all like in a kind of a dialogue and collaborating, many of them. And until the act of 68, closed all the museums, forbid any kind of cultural manifestation. And that's when many artists and thinkers had to leave the country. So the archive is built in a way that allow me to reconnect to what has happening at the time. And was violently repressed in the Brazilian context, as well as in most of Latin America countries at that time. And yesterday, Sonia and Shiba were talking about the wars that are visible and acknowledged, and the ones that are not. And as you probably know, the taking of power of most of the Latin American countries in the 60s and 70s, during the Cold War, so it's a hidden, like a not spoken war, was this hidden occupation organized and strategized by the United States of America. So if during dictatorship so many people disappeared and were tortured and had to leave the country, this mark of repression and humiliation conforms a specific subjectivity under this regime, and 50 years later, there's still the official denial of all the tortures and murderings, and the state insists that many of the people suicide. The bodies were never found and never sent back to the family, so there was never an official acceptance that they were all killed by the state. So I think it's interesting to be able to be here and think of how the local experience compares somehow to the experience in Brazil of our 500 years of colonization, and above all, this new colonizations in the Cold War, that was the military dictatorship was from 1963 to 1985. And while the fact that this happened is denied by the state, the trauma cannot be released somehow. So how could we assess this? And I see this archive as one first tried, not the only one, there's many different models of bringing these things back, like the unspoken stories, including of the Suely herself. So in order to bring this 26 years of corporeal experience of Lygia Clark to the present, Suely also made sure she would bring the context where this all happened through the people that were part of this context. So I will show you little excerpts, maybe 10 minutes of Suely speaking, and just a little, and so that we can have a conversation. So that you have just have a feeling of how this will work. This was shown before in exhibition spaces, but I tell Suely that I think the best way of dealing with this archive is the way that I do with my graduate students in San Francisco, because we work with the whole archive for a semester. So it's really like each one of them chooses a few of the interviews, and then you really can enter. It interests me a lot as an open system of primary material for research. And actually my work is, as I told Alion, is a step after that. So my work is really about not only a connection of this archive with another archive and then arts that are related to it. So today I'm trying to bring their voices more than my own projects, because I felt it was not strictly related. So let's listen a little bit. After doing all the interviews, then Suely was interviewed both by Eva Lambois and Guy Brett.
On va essayer.
Alors, la première fois.
Et 40, c'est 40-50. Et l'époque était très.
And also, I need to say that this is not public yet, the ones with English subtitles. So I had them in a. Suely only gave me to work with my students, so I had them in a French compression, and so we need to look for.
Alors, Rosé, tu as interviewé tous ces gens, et maintenant c'est à toi de passer au caisse.
on va essayer.
Alors, la première question que j'ai vue, tu posais souvent aux gens, et je crois que tu m'as posé aussi, c'était comment s'est passée ta rencontre avec Lygia, comment c'est arrivé, comment tu es tombé sur elle, et comment elle est tombée sur toi.
Bon, les noms de Lygia Clark, je les connaissais évidemment. Mais je suis partie à Paris en exil après 2 mois de prison au Brésil, par la dictature militaire. Et ma prison, c'était lié à la contre-culture et pas à la militance macro-politique. Et c'était une stratégie montée d'avance par le gouvernement militaire pour. Démanteler la contre-culture au Brésil. Et donc, ils ont choisi, j'ai eu la chance d'être choisie, comme un blend de ça, avec 6 autres amis. Et bon, et à ce moment-là, donc, cette époque-là, au Brésil, j'étais complètement dans une vie expérimentale contre-culturelle totale. Et en même temps, j'étais étudiante en sciences sociales à l'Université de São Paulo. Et l'Université de São Paulo et la fac de sciences sociales spécialement, et philo, c'était le centre même de toute la pensée marxiste du Brésil. Et donc j'étais d'un côté très politisée, et je faisais des études de marxisme, et complètement contre-culturelle dans ma quotidienneté. Et ces deux choses-là au Brésil, à ce moment-là, bon encore aujourd'hui, mais à ce moment-là c'était encore pire, c'est des choses qui ne s'articulaient pas du tout. Le mouvement contre-culturel n'était pas du tout vu comme un mouvement politique. Il était très méprisé par les militants et par la société brésilienne, n'en parlons pas. Et la seule partie de la société brésilienne qui voyait dans ce mouvement sa dimension politique, c'est la dictature militaire. La preuve, c'est qu'ils nous ont mis un taule comme ils ont mis les militants. Il y a eu autant de gens qui étaient un taux à cause de la contre-culture que la militance, autant de gens psychiatrisés, torturés, beaucoup de gens qui sont devenus fous, etc. etc. Donc, il y avait une partie de gens de la contre-culture qui vivaient les mêmes conflit que moi. Mm-hmm. Et une partie de ces gens-là, d'ailleurs, j'ai filmé aussi pour, mm-hmm. pour ces projets, parce que ces conflits-là, ils restaient complètement refoulés. Mm-hmm. Aussi bien la dimension politique du mouvement post-culturel que ces conflits-là. Il est resté refoulé sous le trauma de la dictature et il n'est pas revenu. Mm-hmm. Il est toujours ce refoulement. C'est pour ça que j'ai voulu remettre ça à la surface à travers ce film-là, ces entretiens. Donc, j'arrive à Paris, obligée, par exil, mais en arrivant à Paris, c'était le Paris post-68, j'ai immédiatement connu Pierre Clastre qui m'a présenté Guattari, je suis allée...
C'était en quelle année exactement ?
1970. Ma prison, c'était un début, 70, je suis partie en septembre. Et tout de suite, j'étais à Vincennes, je suivais les cours de Deleuze, après je suivais les cours de Foucault au Collège de France. C'était le post 68, j'ai connu tous ces mondes-là et j'ai connu Lygia Clark à Paris.
Par qui?
Je crois que c'est Cathy Colta qui m'a amenée chez mm-hmm. elle la première fois. Je suis pas sûre, je pense que c'est une bonne question. Mm-hmm. Je pense que c'était Cathy Colta, qui est une Brésilienne qui était exilée à Paris aussi. Et ça, pour moi, c'était vraiment une grande chance. Parce que si bien l'ambiance du post-68 parisien que ces théoriciens-là, Pierre Clastre de l'anthropologie, Guattari, Le Foucault, tout ça, d'un côté, et Donard, Lygia Clark, c'était cette articulation que j'ai cherchée ici, qui était, c'était une articulation qui était complètement disqualifiée ici, mm-hmm. comme un faux problème. Ce qui m'avait rendue très très fragile. Aussi, j'étais partie du Brésil très très fragile parce que cette stratégie du gouvernement consistait à mettre dans toutes les médias une interprétation sur la contre-culture qui nous rendait des personnages absolument abominables, des vergondés. Bref. J'étais arrivée à Paris très fragilisée par tout ça, j'avais 21 ans, voilà. Et donc cette rencontre a été absolument fondamentale parce que tout de suite, c'est des choses qui se passent dans l'invisible, qui ne passent pas par la parole et par une intelligibilité immédiate, tout ça, ça faisait sens. Et donc ça a été une rencontre, là, pour me concentrer sur Lygia, c'était une rencontre fondamentale de ma vie. En plus aussi, en tant que femme, elle avait beaucoup à voir avec les choses que je cherchais moi-même en tant que femme, ce qui n'était pas évident au Brésil. Et l'époque était très provinciale, très société disciplinaire, bourgeoise, identitaire, tout ça. Donc c'était une rencontre très importante. Et donc je fréquentais sa maison pendant ces années-là, c'est là que je t'ai connue d'ailleurs.
C'était déjà pour la brune, c'était à cette époque, quand tu l'as
rencontrée. C'était déjà pour la brune, oui. C'était à 72 ou 13. Et voilà, et ensuite, quand elle est rentrée au Brésil en 76, moi je suis encore restée à Paris jusqu'à 79, c'était le moment où j'avais. Parce que au début, j'ai fini socio à Vincennes et j'ai fait philo à Vincennes. Mais entre-temps, j'ai travaillé à la board avec Guattari, j'étais très liée à lui, et j'ai décidé que voulais travailler avec ça, des interventions cliniques dans l'échelle sociale, et donc j'ai fait Paris 7. Et lorsque je devrais faire mon mémoire de DSS, Lygia m'a demandé que je le fasse sur le travail qu'elle commençait à développer au Brésil. Mm-hmm. Elle avait commencé depuis 2 ans, parce que mon DSS était à 78. Et donc c'était sur la structuration du self. Et je me suis complètement consacrée dans une recherche sur ça. Je suis venue au Brésil, je faisais 5 mois fermée dans une recherche, je ne sortais que pour voir Lygia. Et à ce moment-là, on a lu toutes ces notes de séance ensemble pour la thèse et aussi parce qu'il fallait qu'elle écrive un texte qui a été publié dans un petit livre qui a été publié sur elle par la FUNART et ensuite qui a été repris pour le catalogue de l'exposition de ta pièce où c'est le seul texte qu'elle a écrit sur cette expérience qu'on a fait ensemble. Et à cette époque, j'étais pas excepte, j'avais encore des références très psychanalytiques. Mm-hmm. Et je me suis concentrée quand même sur autour des auteurs de la psychanalyse qu'elle aimait elle, et que c'est ceux que j'aimais moi aussi. Ferenczi, Grodeck, Winnicott, tout ça, et Freud, évidemment.
À la fois.
Et alors.
Et Mélanie Klein aussi, non?
Mais Mélanie Klein un peu.
Un peu. Mm-hmm. Et Anna Freud aussi, un peu.
Anna Freud, non? Que je me rappelle.
Ouais. Ah.
les objets partiels, tout ça, Mélanie Klein, lui, la sensibilité qu'avait Mélanie Klein pour cette couche plus primitive de l'inconscient et de la subjectivité. Mais c'était surtout Winnicott, Ferenczi, Grotbeck, Balint, qu'elle aimait beaucoup. Et donc j'ai fait une thèse que j'ai jamais voulu publier parce que je trouvais que c'était pas suffisant. Mais récemment, quand j'ai commencé à faire ce projet autour de cette construction de mémoire, j'ai relu ma thèse parce que je voulais tout relire. Et en fait, c'est la même chose que je travaille maintenant, mais c'était un début. C'est pas mal, mais c'est trop psychanalytique. Mais c'est un début de démarche, mais en fait, elle est centrée exactement sur ce que j'ai toujours cherché à élaborer, qui est autour du corps, la mémoire du corps. Et la thèse s'appelle la mémoire du corps. Voilà, alors ensuite, je suis entrée au Brésil et je la voyais plus rarement, parce que j'habitais à São Paulo et à Rio. J'ai jamais voulu faire une expérience de structuration de self, parce que pour ça, il faudrait que je reste à Rio.
C'est la seule raison?
C'est pas la seule raison, non. Ça, c'est la raison objective, consciente. À vrai dire, ça m'intéressait complètement comme démarche de recherche. Ça m'intéressait pas comme démarche thérapeutique. Mais aujourd'hui, je peux dire. Aujourd'hui, je regrette de ne pas le faire. Mais en même temps, je sais pourquoi j'avais une ambiguïté par rapport à considérer ça comme si elle avait dévié de l'art vers la thérapie. Aujourd'hui, je sais pourquoi. Donc, il y avait quelque chose qui me dérangeait là-dedans. Mais c'était ça, c'était pas une histoire de me protéger de ce que j'aurais pu vivre dans ces sciences, parce que ça, au contraire, j'avais très envie de passer par toutes sortes de traitements pour guérir toutes les traces des traumas que j'avais vécu. Et puis, c'est des choses qui m'intéressaient énormément. Mais j'aimais pas, et là, aujourd'hui, je suis sûre de ça, qu'on cette interprétation qu'elle aurait abandonné l'art pour devenir thérapeute.
Oui, parce que tu vois ça comme, cette dernière phase de son travail, comme une proposition parmi dans une chaîne de nombreuses autres qui découlent de son travail artistique et qui, ben, à partir des années 60, elle part de propositions de toute façon déjà, donc c'est une proposition, c'est ça?
C'est une proposition, en fait, mais c'est pas uniquement une parmi d'autres, c'est comme
la culmination.
La clé de voûte de tout le reste, c'est la culmination, évidemment, si elle n'était pas morte, il y aurait une autre culmination, je ne sais rien. Mais disons que c'est la démarche, qu'à mon avis, je ne sais pas si je me trompe, mais je suis assez persuadée de ça pour l'instant, qu'à mon avis, donne la clé de l'ensemble, du cœur même de sa pensée poétique, de son investigation depuis le début, depuis la peinture. Ça nous permet d'appréhender ça. Et je pense que si on la place trop vite dans le champ thérapeutique, on perd la virulence du territoire qu'elle a ouvert, aussi bien du côté de l'art que du côté de la thérapie. Et ça a des effets très intéressants des deux côtés. Et je pense que c'est le summum de sa recherche parce que depuis son tournant en 63, quand elle abandonne la sculpture et la peinture après, à partir de Camignan, donc cheminant, à 63, et puis toutes les propositions qu'elle a montées, et qu'elle cherchait, à mon avis, de provoquer à travers les objets et les dispositifs qu'elle montait une ouverture dans la capacité sensible du récepteur. Et que si on pense, on peut penser ça de plusieurs points de vue, mais on peut penser aussi par rapport au système de l'art, c'est vraiment aller à contrepoids de ce qui était devenu les spectateurs de l'art dans le système de l'art. Lorsqu'elle a eu l'opportunité de suivre l'expérience du récepteur, quand elle a enseigné à Sorbonne et que là elle pouvait accompagner les effets de son travail dans le temps, c'était des semestres entiers, un groupe énorme de gens, deux fois par semaine, 3 heures, là elle s'est rendue compte que c'était impossible à travers ces démarches de convoquer cette capacité du sensible chez les récepteurs, parce qu'à partir du moment qu'on convoque, on mobilise cette capacité-là, on mobilise aussi toutes les traumas, les impossibilités de qui était la cause du refoulement, cette capacité qui est très grave, et pour la société, et politiquement, et tout, et pour l'esthétique, ne parlons pas, pour l'expérience esthétique, parce qu'elle se passe là. Et donc, elle s'est rendue compte qu'il fallait traiter ça, et que donc, la dernière proposition qu'elle a inventée consistait exactement au lieu que cette mobilisation de fantasmes et du refoulé soit comme un effet collatéral de ces propositions, qui soit au cœur même, au centre même de la proposition. Donc elle voulait explorer les pouvoirs qu'avaient ces objets de convoquer cette mémoire-là, et aussi les pouvoirs qu'avaient ces objets de la guérir. Elle parlait de vomir la fantasmatique.
Okay, so each of the interviews are like an hour and a half. I will just show an excerpt of a few other ones. It's much shorter, so that you have a feeling of. So Guy Brecht is a critic and curator from London. And
if you hold us. Well, I actually met Lygia in 1965 in Rio.
In Rio?
In Rio de Janeiro, in her apartment. I went to her apartment.
She was already in Radio Zoom.
Yeah, she was. Yeah. Yeah, but I had seen some of her work before, because some of her work had been sent to the Signals gallery in London, and these were mainly Bichos. She sent them, I think, but for a sort of small exhibition with other artists at Signals. At that time, Signals, you know, was this gallery that was started by David Medalla and Paul Keeler, and at that time it was in their apartment. See, before they moved to this big building they had later in Wigmore Street in London, right in the centre, they had a flat there, and all the works were exhibited there, and the public could come in. And I'd seen the Bichos and Lygia, and at first I didn't give them much importance, because I thought, well, these are very beautiful abstract works, and you know, in the tradition of geometric abstraction. And I didn't see them. I could only see them in this way, in this limited way. It seemed to belong to a genre of geometric abstract sculpture, and that's how I saw it. And it was only after meeting Lygia and also reading her writings, because when she later had an exhibition at Signals in 1965, they published a special issue of the journal with her writings. Her writings have been translated into English. And I was very impressed by her writings, because not only that made me see the Bichos in another context, in another development, but also I found her writings extremely lucid, essential, and profound. And I still do. I mean, I still recapture that moment of first reading her writing. So I met her in 1965, and she was completely different from what I was expecting.
Yeah. Yes, I can imagine.
You know, from the work, I had this idea of a rather quiet, serious person. Sort of modest in appearance, and then I met Lygia, and she was this kind of extravagant, beautiful, gorgeous woman, so that immediately made me think, oh, this is really something fascinating. Can I see this work in relation to her as she was? I got really more and more interested. And then, so I remember her apartment. I remember her showing me the works there.
What work?
No, it was 65, so I think she was just making the rubber pieces at that time. And probably I saw those, which I liked very much. Ouvre. Yeah, Ouvre. Mm-hmm. And also she had in her apartment some items of popular art, Brazilian popular art. And I remember a big construction of straw, which had things sticking in it, like, I think it was something that was carried in the street, or I don't know, just have a vague memory of this and some other other object.
So I think maybe one thing that it's quite striking when you watch is that, for instance, so Guy Brett is a curator and critic from London, so he has a very specific way of addressing the work. He's very articulated. He's close in 65 to Lygia Clark, and they had all this correspondence until her death. And so each person that you see talking, I will show just a little, like, there's an edition of another two. It's very rich in the sense that they're completely different. Like, another one is Caetano Veloso. I don't know if it's any familiar, the name here, but he's a very pop musician in Brazil. And it's a situation that they're public people, and you would never see them in the way you see in these films, because they are really in this kind of, I think it's really like a psychoanalytic way of speaking, but also they're all same generation, so Suely, they're friends in 60, 65, so there's some kind of opening in a very generous way, I feel, that allow us to kind of slowly understand and entering their own memories and understand some relations, sometimes personal, but that creates this bigger, this broader view of a time. So I just show, let me see what time is it, Caetano Veloso. It's really just to keep this feeling of the thing.
If you hold a stone.
Well, the music in all the videos is actually by
Caetano.
If
you feel the way
you see only one introduction.
To understand.
And in the beginning, there's only a few excerpts that I don't think is the most interesting part, but I will show you just this beginning in this.
If you feel the way you'll never be late.
This is from another exhibition.
Eu conheci Lígia, eu já estava em Londres e fui a Paris. Então, primeiro foi ela, marcou um encontro no apartamento dela e botou depois a toalha da mesa no chão, aí fez um piquenique que a gente jantasse. E ela me disse: pô, eu pus essa rosa de plástico dentro da garrafa de Coca-Cola para fazer uma homenagem romântica assim, para lhe receber. É como arte pop, que é como as coisas de vocês tropicalistas, que são coisas muito fortes e interessantes, mas são românticas. Precisa de ter uma relação direta com aquilo a que se refere. Eu não me identifico nada com isso porque eu sou clássica. E a minha ideia é agir diretamente nas formas essenciais de uma maneira atemporal. Conversar com Lígia, estar na presença dela, já era uma experiência sempre interessante e surpreendente. Escrevi até uma canção que dediquei a ela num disco já tem Londres, If You Hold a Stone, para causa da pedra da Lígia. Já estava no Brasil quando ela começou a fazer uma espécie de psicoterapia. Eu acompanhava aquilo como quem acompanha a composição de um ritmo. Tinha um ritmo profundo, misterioso, até aquelas coisas que ela punha sobre o corpo da gente, do sopro, da aproximação da mão, mas ficava com essa consciência de que eu estava tendo uma experiência mais estética do que terapêutica. Nos anos 60, eu estava querendo mudar o modo de fazer canções no Brasil e de se interpretar o que significava a canção dentro da sociedade brasileira. E depois no mundo, ela e sobretudo Lígia participaram dessa experiência toda. Foi muito auspicioso, porque eram pessoas muito especiais, figuras incríveis do mundo, né? Assim, naquela época.
So she, this is just like an introduction to all the. Each interview has this, only the ones that. the ones that she presented in exhibition. So actually there is a box that was published with Portuguese subtitles in Brazil, and there's a box that was published in with French subtitles in France, and then it's 20 interviews, but she couldn't get the, she doesn't have the English translations yet. And so Caetano did the structuring of the self. So he's describing all his, for an hour and a half, he's kind of talking about Lygia, but also describing his experience in this therapy. And just to finish, I also will show just the introduction of one of her, a couple that were her students, and they met in Lygia Clark in Sorbonne. And I mean, you just get to know when you listen to the whole thing, but, and this music, it's like, you feel like, it's annoying, the music after.
La notion de corps collectif, elle se répandait, enfin, on se répandait sur la surface de ce papier et on fondait. Et les cours de Lygia permettaient cette approche de l'autre. Il y avait la découverte de l'autre comme sa propre découverte à soi. C'était une manière de remplir, de gonfler la proposition de l'intérieur. Pour investir totalement une proposition de Lygia, il fallait accepter de se vider de sa propre substance à soi, de ce que l'on était, les images de soi et tout ce qui concerne les bienséances, la société. Par contre, il fallait essayer de retrouver ce qui était la chair mentale. Quand j'ai abordé Saint-Charles, j'étais absolument ignorante, j'étais ignarde. Et je suis rentrée de plein pied dans quelque chose qui était la contemporanéité de l'art. Et toute la partie géométrique, toute la partie des choses, c'était intéressant parce que c'était une grande rétrospective, on avait bien une idée de son parcours, donc c'était intéressant. Et toutes ces choses-là sont des choses qui se regardent, qui sont dans la représentation. Mais face à tous ces masques qui étaient inertes sur les estrades, il manquait, c'était sans vie. C'est pour ça que c'est difficile maintenant de la mettre dans un musée, parce que tout était inhérent à elle-même. C'est elle qui provoquait la chose et c'est d'elle qu'émanait tout ce qui ressortait de son mouvement.
Ok. So, before we open for conversation, I hope there was a material for us to discuss. I just, my last thinking was about how this can be seen as a documentary, in the sense that mostly the documentaries are, and you were talking yesterday about not making a documentary, and like 3 days ago, I was thinking about this as in the sense that it documents all these people, but most of times the documentary has this edition and becomes one line of thought, and most of times the director trying to prove something or to bring something into as reality, like an absolute. And here, you never have this, you never have the position of Suely herself. So somehow, I feel she, as well as Lygia Clark, would say that her work was, she was the mold, and people should breathe on it, referring to the plastic bags. So she was the proposer, and things will only happen in the dialogue. I feel this archive of interviews is somehow also, it's really like somehow taking this position of opening and letting all these people speak and then letting us enter it. And it's kind of not infinite, but a multiple, you can get so many different readings of and specific research depending on how you, on what you watch and how you, whom you connect. So that's what I had to bring. Thank you very much for your patience. And I would like to open for questions and hopefully discussion. When I...
the distinction between art and therapy. Do you think it's possible to distinguish them? Or do you think that's useful?
I'm not sure it's useful. I just think it's very important, at least like from my field, which is art, I think it's very important not to instrumentalize art. So I never think it's like art as therapy or art as changing a social or urban context. I think art plays more in another, what I was talking yesterday, the micropolitics of art. So it affects people in other ways. And so I don't see it as a way to cure people in the sense that a psychoanalytical session would be, but it's like creating this.
Maybe you could say something about the difference between psychoanalysis and psychotherapy, because not many people go through psychoanalysis for healing, whereas a lot of people go through psychotherapy for healing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe I used the wrong terms, but. But I feel it's what I think it's very interesting, and also the part I show of the interview with Suely is when she gets to this moment when she say that the most interesting thing of Lygia's work was that she would expand both areas. So either if you would say she abandoned the art as this exhibition, but all the exhibitions are mostly in U.S. That show her work say that, well, this is the artist that she was so radical that she left the art territory to become a therapist. And then you really lose it, this expansion of both fields. And I don't think she was neither in one or the other. And at that moment, Lygia would say she was doing a therapy. And this, I don't know, talking to Suely, she thinks that that it's because it was so out of the understanding of the general. She thought she was going totally crazy because, like, the art scene or the artists, all the artists that were around her would really think she was not doing anything anymore and this could not be seen as art. So she said, okay, I'm doing therapy. So that's why also it's very important to bring it back somehow, because it's like it's part, I think for the last 15 years, it became so important or relevant for the discussion of the time. And I think this is also what I tried to say yesterday when we deal with this micropolitical level of you never know when this will resonate on a certain time, on a certain people. So when she was doing it, it could not resonate. So it's really, so this is really a disarchive, but also my work in other terms is like, how can you then bring it back, but not as a documentation or as a photo or as, but bring it back with the same power, you know, with the urgency, and so that it can be active in the present. I don't know. I don't think I responded the relation of psychoanalysis and therapy, but it's.
I just want to say, in response to what you were saying, I just wanted to say, just wanted to add to the conversation, really, which is that I was recently, watching a documentary on Damien Hirst's pharmacy. I think he had this particular installation where he actually had a pharmacy inside a gallery, you know, and sort of through that method was. Really problematizing the entire pharmaceutical industry and, you know, its own aesthetics and things like that. And I think that it was the continuation of a trend that probably someone like Lygia had started, you know, with putting therapy into, problematizing therapy and sort of really looking at it from a very artistic point of view, mm-hmm. too. And in fact, just yesterday, I had gone to a special needs school where there was this person. He was a music therapist, and of course he was operating as a clinical musical therapist. He wasn't really, he had left his, you know, he had sort of categorized himself in that particular scenario as a clinical musical therapist, despite the fact that he was a musician also on the side. But it was very interesting the way he was using the sensorial, the limited sensorial abilities of some of these children as starting points to have a conversation and to through music, and just those little spaces of dialogue that were constructed, and it was really beautiful. I just want to say that I think art does that. It the more it problematizes, the better, I think, sometimes.
Thank you. I think that one thing that is important is, and maybe it touches the relation between the cycle that Leon is interested in, schizo, you know, all this notion. It's that the difference of acting in a social level. So I think Lygia Clark never left this field of acting in the social body, even when she was treating one by one. It was not about this person and this specific, it was at this moment, but I think she always had this this motivation and this ambition that it comes with the artist, that is like transforming society or even humanity, you know, transforming in a social, having a social impact. And I think maybe this is what differentiates to an art therapy. Yes.
Can I invite you to return Lygia, in a sense, to the art practices of the 60s? You say that she started calling herself, chose to call herself a therapist because many people said, are you doing art, or does it belong to art? But if we now retrospectively were to look at a map of art practices through the 60s and the 70s, there might be another gestalt that we would get of Lygia. Obviously, and if I might, without expanding this talk, which is very concentrated and very, very, very engaging through Lygia and Suely Rolnik herself, but just for a moment, if we were to map the 60s and the early 70s, it might actually enlarge the art historical as well as I wouldn't like to call it social, but the micropolitical that you're speaking about.
Yep.
So first of all, if you might just touch upon, if there's time to do that, or at least make a general comment on the relationship, clearly first and foremost, with Elio Wojtyszyka. That would be one direction to take it into. The other would be the certain selected artists from Fluxus. I'm not suggesting that they are one-to-one relationships, but these are the contexts of the 60s and the early 70s. Then also, I thought that possibly the new experiments with dance that were taking place at the Judson Church, for example, in New York, with Yvonne Rainer and Trisha Brown, and then much later Pina Bausch, the kind of use of the body in relation to object had changed completely by that time.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, of course, feminism itself, and how we would read her in relationship to feminist practices from the late 60s into the 70s. So consider into the 70s primarily, but consider Anya Mendieta. I think that would give us some kind of another trajectory and a clue. And even possibly the first sets of works of Mary Kelly, postpartum documents. So I'm trying to say that, can we put Lygia Clark now in the larger context of art practices and not necessarily make her certainly the innovator and the contributor to a new way of looking at art and therapy and so on.
Yeah.
Turn her to art history.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I think this shift of contemporary art in 50s to 60s, this was happening all over. And in the 90s, there's the need to go back there. And so when people need to trace these new stories and include them in a main hegemonic story, that's exactly when they go back to Elio Wojtyszyka and Lygia Clark and another artist in Latin America. But I think I was very focused here in order to bring this, but all the artists of Fluxus and in Latin America as well. But I think the context at this point, under the dictatorship of Cold War, both of Eastern Europe and Latin America, there was somehow not... The exchange, of course, Lygia and Elio Wojtyszyka is this Brazilian artist that is considered like probably most of you heard of it. So they are considered the most important internationally. Let's say in Brazil, there was many others doing more interesting things as well. And so they were in this very intense correspondence. And somehow it feels when you read all the letters that Elio Oitsika was the only one somehow that would understand what she was doing or would respond. And his work is also, they start both from the same source. So they were really into Mondrian. And so there's it's a movement in Brazil, right? So I didn't want to go to the art history, but of course there's the concrete movement in São Paulo, the new concrete in Rio de Janeiro, which is like breaking with all this, the concrete in São Paulo had this influence of Max Biel from the School of Ulm, and the new concrete somehow was like breaking all this abstraction, the geometric abstraction, into life, if we say in a very basic way. And Suely, Lygia is only one example of it, and more and more, I think we could see since the beginning of the 90s how everywhere this was all the negation of the object and how to produce. What I was going to say. But then when it first, so in Brazil, and it happens very often, there's no publication on the complete works of Elio Oitsika or Lygia Clark. It's always like when some mostly European curator is interested in these. They come, they do the research, and they publish in Europe, for instance. Mostly, I think in the 90s was more Catherine Davy that did the exhibition of Elio, a complete exhibition of Elio Oitsika and at Jeu de Paume, and then publish a book that until today is the only complete book with his work. And then Lygia Clark also, it was Corinne Désiré and Manolo in Barcelona at MACBA, and they did a book that still all the writings I got from this book, and it sold out. So, but just to say that even these people that were really interested and were trying to rewrite history somehow. So in Documenta 10, I remember seeing, I was very young, but I remember seeing the masks of Lygia Clark in a shelf with lots of dust, you know, like they were. So every time I would see the work, they look so unattractive, so old. I don't know what was your feeling, but if you don't know, like, because it's not something to be seen, they are done in this material, you know, like very precarious material, but it's not a representation of precarity. And I'm not saying that the curator, Catherine Davy, didn't know it, but it's like, how can you bring it back to the present? So it's a try. So this work and many others is like, how do you bring into the public sphere and into reflection with the same power that it had before? Even Elio Oitsika, I remember seeing in the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, the work, and it could look very... with this aesthetic of precariousness that it was not exactly what they were. I don't know, I think it goes much further than this, but if you just keep the object or the material or the parangolé, this is a good example. I don't know how familiar you are, but it's a basic example, it's a typical example of how the museums are not able to collect contemporary art. So it's a piece of fabric, color, with colors, and Elio Oitsika was working with the people, the samba school in the favela in Rio de Janeiro. He was really engaged with these people, and so this was in order to bring the color, the painting, into the space and into life. So they will come, this samba people, and he was very like counterculture and subversive at his time. So he brought these people, and there was an exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art in Rio de Janeiro. And he came without telling, with all these people from the favela, the samba school people, playing and dressed with these colors. And so the work, in my view, only exists when there's the music and the dance. But it became this, so if you see any place in Tate Modern, or if you see in any museum in Europe or US, you have a piece of fabric, a color fabric, like hung in an exhibition space. So I don't know if I'm going too far, but I think it's clearly part of an art history that was that more and more it's part of a hegemonic history because it has been revisited and revisited again, but still so hard to touch it. Even for me, I'm from there. I know for a long time the sculptures, the paintings, I understand it, but it's always like, and then people put these plastic bags and a photo of her, a big photo in the museum of her, the place where she would work with the people, you know? And it's like, why do I need to see this? So this is one point. The other...
Why do you call it hegemonic history? I mean, the incorporation of this history does not necessarily have to make it hegemonic.
No.
It can keep its head, it can keep its avant-garde.
What I mean is like in the main exhibitions or anthologies produced in the US or in Europe, it, like conceptual art used to be something and suddenly there's a revision and then Cildo Meirelles, a Brazilian artist, becomes part of an anthology called conceptual art. So this means it's part of this, what I call hegemonic or mainstream history, let's say. But what I'm saying is that it's very important for us being from there to think, okay, the name is there, so that you bring it there, but how do you show it with the same power that the work really had instead of creating this, like the exhibition at MoMA, you know, it was like 3 months ago in 2014, I mean, and it's called The Abandoned, Lygia Clark and the Abandonment of Art, which is like very sad that it's still someone. And about feminist, I was thinking yesterday if there's something similar here, I don't know, but it's very curious how in Brazil, it's one of the few countries I know where feminism in art is not such an issue, because as Cildo says, you can trace a history of art of Brazilian, the most important Brazilian artists from the 20th century are all female. So even in the avant-garde, like in 1914 and 16, so the two main artists are Tarsila do Amaral and Anita Malfatti. And then if you think in the from this move from 50s to 60s, the main artists internationally, but also in Brazil, the ones that got very recognized is Lygia Clark, Lygia Papp, and Elliot Sica. And I always say to my students in San Francisco, in the graduate program, that have this very fixed idea of identity, like, you know, women, and or that Elliot Sica was gay, but this is never spoken of because it's not so relevant, you know, like he's considered as a very important artist. But then the Cara de Cavallo was his boyfriend. I don't know, this is just to deconstruct a little bit the idea of identity that in US is so reinforced. But it's not, I'm not saying this is a good thing, but even in the present, if you think of all the artists, the more expensive artists, you can think of Beatriz Milhazes, Adriana Varejão, so there's Rosângela Renault, so there's even the young generations, there was never less, even more women. And I discussed this with some feminists because I was somehow formed working with, I don't know, Maria Lind and Uta Metabauer, and we discussed that probably it comes from a country, like a culture where working with the hands, it's not something related to power or to dignity, so it's something that comes from, so women would do this, and then in the 20th century, I don't know, there's many, and yesterday, I don't know, I was asking someone, because I had the feeling, maybe I'm mistaken, that here in India, there are many recognized and good artists that are females.
Of course.
Yeah, and sorry, I was totally ignorant about this before, but I felt it like in the last 2 days, and I thought, wow, because the only country where I see this similar to Brazil is Colombia in South America. If you think of the main key artists, they are all female. And I have this feeling of here as well. So, sorry, any
It's just a comment really, because you're talking about all these European art historians who've written on Lygia Clark's work, but there's an Indian art historian. I mean, of course, she's trained in corporeal and she's trained in Cambridge, but Rakhi Balram, she's an Indian art historian who's just written extensively on Lygia Clark's work.
Mm-hmm.
And her work, the micro environment,
she invents Lygia Clark's works in the 1970s is actually the feminist movements of Paris, I mean in France,
mm-hmm.
women's movements in France.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something, her book is to come out soon from Yale University Press, so I think that might be something that's...
Yeah. I don't mean to be anti-European, I'm sorry. If it's just...
There is another artist on it who's recently...
Yeah, but Lygia Clark would not consider herself as a feminist. I'm sure the research is interesting, and I would... But she would not consider herself as a feminist, as well as Suely doesn't. And, but it's... I think there's a certain position. But I don't know, maybe it's... Try not to be under any of these models, words that come from the fight for civil rights, or you know, in the U.S. or there's something. Yeah, this will go through, but it goes through what something that really says about the macro politics and the micro politics and how things are transforming all the time. I don't know, but. Yeah. Of course, she can be read, and there's many readings of Lygia Clark work, and I think it's great that more and more. But it's my concern is more on how it is presented.
It might be interesting to also look at something which has been around in the 20th century in certain kind of aspects of art cinematic practices. Like when you're looking at her works. One of the genealogies that you kind of start thinking about right from the beginning to when she kind of goes into so-called therapy is our figures like, say, the filmmaker like Maya Deren, for example. Maya Deren, Deren the American filmmaker,
mm-hmm.
who is an avant-garde filmmaker, but then goes into research into the occult. She does a research in Haiti, basically on voodoo and things like that, and she comes back. And she does a lot of film, she does film work connected to that. So, I mean, when you're looking at a geometrical abstractions and then moving into therapy, one would look at a line coming from, say, Duchamp, then Deren, and then, you know, and there is this relationship that is there between objects, occult, the feminine in artistic practice, which is, I think, another genealogy which might be interesting,
mm.
especially in the context of schizoanalysis and things like that,
mm.
where, you know, certain kinds of Maya Deren also has a third world kind of, you know, she works with a third world in a certain sense,
mm.
and her background is also very interesting. I mean, that might be another line, you know, the occult, the
mm-hmm.
feminine, and what can't be seen, the invisible, the social, the political, which is conceptualized in a very personal way by a woman, but that need not go into a feminist line, but can go into some other kind of, you know,
mm-hmm.
processes of deterritorialization and very personal vision of objects and bodies and, you know,
mm-hmm.
flows.
Mm-hmm.
I was just wondering if that, you know, I mean, looking at her work and the trajectories, I mean, I just kept on thinking about people like Deren and women who've kind of worked with the occult and the body and objects and things like
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, it's a rich work, and it can be
yeah.
tracing different thinking. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. So maybe we. Anyone else wants to ask
any other questions
or say something?
Yeah, you were talking about the repression in the 60s and the experience of the body that follows, that would be like the most immediate and the most important kind of repression to the individual. And I was wondering on a more macro political level what's happening today. There is a president, Dilma Rousseff, I think is her
mm-hmm.
name. And if I'm not totally mistaken, she was among the protesters in the 60s and
mm-hmm.
she was jailed and tortured
yeah.
as well. So how is it possible that this issue today is not addressed by the state if mm-hmm. the head of the state was one of them.
Yeah, it has been addressed for the last 2 years. They create a committee of the, it's called Comité da Verdade, Committee of the True. And so this committee interview many people and militar, and this has led to searches of bodies and acceptions. But it's still, they close on the 31st of December 2014. They close all their reports. And beginning from this, so it will start tracing, but it's not officially accepted still, like Herzog, the journalist that disappeared and the family know, and so he was in a prison, and then there's a photo of him hung, and the family knows he was killed and tortured. So until today, they didn't say officially, okay, he didn't kill himself, he was killed by the regime. So there is a process of going, but at the same time, unfortunately, the macro political situation is not even Dilma Rousseff being in the presidency. For instance, last year with the World Cup, it was installed a state of exception, I think it's called in English martial law, because of the, with all people coming. So many people, including that I know, like artists that are not white or half black, white, and live in the peripheries, but many people I know, mostly young, they will be kept by the police and they are hit and many people are killed in a very sophisticated, hidden way. So it's somehow like there's a big, there was this movement that finally people came out in the streets in Brazil in June 2013. And this is somehow like the, I don't know, I see it as exactly this explosion of something that was from before and needs to be open, but the people would expect from this president that she would react differently to this. And the way she and, her team reacted was to put the national forces, she gave the martial law, I don't know if it's like this everywhere, but in Brazil it's like, during the World Cup, she gave the power to the military, so the police will not anymore have their. It's like we are not more in a. We don't have the citizens don't have rights while you are in the state, and the most powerful the in charge are the militaries. So there was some planes from the militaries all over, and they were like, yes, hitting people, and there was many manifestations, and there was like in Rio de Janeiro during the World Cup, there was 45 students and even a professor of philosophy that they were taken as activists, and they disappeared for like 30 days as political prisoners. So it's really a state of we are still trying to understand it, but it's a very complicated moment, I think.